subject is senior housing, and since the housing market has taken off again in the last year, there's been an enormous upsurge of developer monies become available in California for park closures. There are currently 4 active park closures occurring in the state of California, 2 in Southern California, 1 in Palo Alto, 1 in San Jose. Park closures are now the largest threat to mobile home owners on the horizon. I have appeared before the local housing element, and I'm here for you tonight to request that the city enact a comprehensive park closure ordinance for the park residents of California. A park closure ordinance would go a long way along with the existing zoning and the RSO in protecting the mobile home residents in the city of Calistoga. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. If I could ask the information you have on that type of ordinance from other communities, if you can share that with staff, that would be information on other communities who've done such a comprehensive park closure ordinance. Thank you. I have no other speaker cards. Is anyone else interested in addressing the council on a consent calendar item or a non-agendized item? Not seeing any movement, I will close oral communication and will seek a motion for adoption of tonight's agenda.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Motioned by Council Member Krause, seconded by Vice Mayor Dunsford. Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Thank you. Council requests and ideas for discussion. Council Member Lopez Ortega.
Nothing.
Thank you. Council Member Barnes.
Yes. With your permission, Mr. Mayor, I would like to adjourn tonight's meeting in honor of the two journalists who have been slain in the last 2 weeks over in the Middle East. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Krause.
I have a couple of things. I was rudely awakened the other day. I think just about everybody in this room that was here was rudely awakened as well, unless you were already up. An earthquake. There's a couple of comments I'd like to make about that. One is, back during my tenure as fire chief, we had a earthquake alarm installed at the fire station that was to alert people in the fire station that an earthquake was imminent and also open the station doors. It worked when I was the fire chief, and now that we've done an earthquake renovation on the station, I'm curious as to whether or not it worked the other morning. The other thing is, I noticed that the county, of course, has declared a state of emergency, and I believe we are included in that. It might be advisable for us to also declare a state of emergency, even though at this point we have very little damage, although I think the pumps down at the treatment plant. Mike, is that what's on here? Is the pumps at the treatment plant, we're putting that under a state of emergency? But is for different reasons. Okay. At any rate, I've always been concerned since we had a report on the Fage Canyon water tank that is not securely anchored to its foundation and could slip off its foundation in a significant earthquake, as well as the connections that go between the pipe and the tank. I recall a presentation that Derek, I think it was, put on several months ago, perhaps a year or two ago. With the declaration of an emergency in the county, there is a percentage of the total damage under the Stafford Act that will be given to the county in the form of grants to prepare for future earthquakes. That's how we got the earthquake retrofit on the fire station. Because we were in the affected county, we successfully requested a grant and got some substantial grant funding to do the earthquake retrofit on there. I think we're in the same position again on Fage Canyon. Now, I know there's been some discussion as to whether we should repair Fage Canyon or go to a different site and everything else, and some of that may be just so many pipe dreams. The fact of the matter is that that was a pun, incidentally, a pipe dream. Okay, all right, you all
we're
got
all going to let all that right. go.
Okay, well, this may be an opportunity to go after some substantial disaster mitigation funds. I think that's what they're called, and get some money to go after that. On a little bit of a different note, I have to apologize to the Sharpstein Museum folks for not being at their event the other day. But instead of being at that event, I was over at the back-to-school event for the elementary school that was sponsored by the Family Center. And I can tell you that based on what I saw there, our contributions to the Family Center are well spent, because that was an outstanding event. There must have been 20 different agencies represented there, including our recreation department, police department. There were several, there was one service club there, the Seroptimist. Amazingly, the Rotary Club wasn't there. There's a former Rotary Club member there, that would be me, but Rotary Club wasn't there, Jim. And but it was a great event, and I think the folks that attended that found a lot of help that's there with everything from health issues to learning disabilities, just a tremendous amount of help that's available. And certainly our support of the Family Center is well placed.
Thank you, Councilman. Thank you, sir. I do believe, correct me if I'm wrong, City Manager Spittler, we did inquire about the necessity for a separate state of emergency, but were informed that once your county declares, you fall under that writ and are protected as such, correct?
That's what County Council has advised.
Okay. Vice Mayor Dunsford.
Nothing.
Thank you. Two items to follow up on Councilmember Krause's earthquake comment. We were very, very lucky as a community. Yes, we rattled a little bit, but there was relatively, if not any, interruption in any utility services, no damages to homes with the exception of a glass or two that may have fallen over. We escaped relatively unharmed, and we're very lucky to have that situation. With that said, that left this community in a position to help our friends down south in Napa. And immediately with the Calistoga Fire Department sending crew and equipment to assist the situation they had going on immediately, and then also with the commitment from our public works team for crew and equipment during the week, which I believe some of was utilized. So the entire county did come together for that, and again, very lucky up here in Calistoga. But it makes us think about, to Councilmember Krause's point, making sure we're taking stock of some other issues we may have, and there is an agenda item coming up on this in that category. So thank you very much. And then last is a reminder that this Sunday is the Harvest Table, Calistoga's first Harvest Table, dinner down Lincoln Avenue. Just a reminder to all the residents, whether you're participating or not in this event, Lincoln Avenue will be closed to all traffic starting at 1 p.m. and will not reopen to traffic until 11 p.m. There will be clearly marked routes through town, and if you're local, you know how to get through town, even with Lincoln Avenue closed. So we look forward to that. Just be mindful to allow yourself a little extra time to get from one side to the next. All right. I will entertain a motion on the consent calendar unless any item needs to be pulled.
So move the consent calendar.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilmember Barnes, a second by Councilmember Krause. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you. Consent calendar passes. There are no public hearings, so we'll move on to item number H, which is general government, and this is item number 3, consideration of a resolution approving a stipulation and proposed order regarding Chateau Calistoga settlement of petition for writ of administrative mandamus. And I believe the recommended action, I know the recommended action, is to adopt the resolution, and I believe City Manager Spittler will lead us on this, and then we will have sage advice if needed from our city attorney.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. What is before you is a recommendation to approve a resolution authorizing the mayor to enter into a stipulation agreement with the owner of the Chateau Mobile Home Park and the city of Calistoga, which addresses approximately 11 properties that were not part of the mediation settlement back in 2012. The owner of Chateau Mobile Home Park did file for a rent increase in 2011, and according to our rent stabilization ordinance, our RSO, that kicked off a mediation process. During that process, most of the residents in that park entered into a settlement agreement with the owner of Chateau, which provided for a small rent increase over a number of years and ending in a CPI, so that they would have peace and security of how much to anticipate rent increases through May 31st, 2019. There were 11 property owners or mobile homeowners that did not enter into this agreement. So the under the provisions of our RSO, that kicked off arbitration process. There was an administrative judge appointed, and at the end of the hearing process, the judge ruled in favor of the 11 residents and granted no rent increase to the owner of Chateau Mobile Home Park. However, very soon after, he filed a lawsuit against the city, finding that the administrative judge's decision was improper and relied on a faulty 2008 base year for determining what was proper income to the mobile home park owner. We, as the city, they turned around and offered a settlement agreement with the city, and the council basically was open to, as we usually are, to try to settle things without going into litigation. But a big part of that was that the affected residents, those amongst the 11 properties, be a part of this so that they were satisfied with the outcome. It's taken a long while, but I'm pleased to report that I believe we have an agreement, a settlement agreement, which protects these residents through May 31st, 2019, where they would be subject to a CPI increase each year, but they would have the same security going forward as the other residents through their settlement agreement. In return, the property owner has the right after June 2019, to argue, should there be another rent increase proposed under our RSO, to argue that the 2008 base year was the wrong year chosen as the base year. Obviously, the city, the residents can argue otherwise. So the owner has signed the proposed stipulation and proposed order, as I summarized, and it's up to the council to decide after public comment whether to allow the mayor to sign this agreement. We will then file it in the Superior Court. Once that's done, I think the matter will be settled. That concludes my staff report. Matt Vasek with the City Attorney's Office is here. He was instrumental in helping me negotiate this agreement. If you have any technical legal questions. That concludes my presentation.
Thank you, City Manager Spiller. Council members, any questions before I open or of the city attorney?
I have one question. The settlement agreement requirement require the park owner to petition with prejudice. It's my understanding that that means once this agreement is signed, he cannot come back and sue us again. Is that correct?
Very nearly correct. It means that once this agreement is signed by both the park owner and the city and submitted to the court, if the court enters it as an order, which we anticipate that they would, then this would be over and done. Be no further lawsuit and no right of appeal.
Thank you. I think that's an important point that everybody needs to understand.
Matt, under the RSO, the mobile home park owner is entitled to an annual CPI, cost of living increase, right?
That's correct. Automatically
so,
every year.
Automatically every year. So basically, the 11 people that was originally 11, I understand one has since passed away, they will only have the very minimal increase that is allowed under the RSO until 2019.
That is.
Or actually, June 1st, 2019. And then the owner has the ability, however, to start this whole process over again.
The owner, at the expiration of this agreement, which would be June 1st, 2019, the owner could come back and seek another extraordinary rent increase, but which is a rent increase in excess of the CPI.
Okay.
However, it would be subject to our RSO provision.
Correct. Under our RSO, without this agreement, the park owner could go back to 10 surviving tenants next year and once again argue an extraordinary rent increase and do that essentially every year at his choosing, correct?
That's correct. The park owner, any park that is subject to the RSO, if the park owner unsuccessfully brings an application for an extraordinary rent increase and loses, they can bring another one the following year. They lose, they can bring another one the following year. They're limited to one per year.
Okay. So essentially, as far as that park is concerned, is we have taken all of the jeopardy that these 10 tenants have and eliminated it till June 1st of 2019.
Correct. It would be entirely predictable rent increase.
Great.
So that applies to all of the tenants, not only the 11, correct? Because they had their agreement under a separate hearing with a whole different judge.
The discussion before us, though, is only on this.
Oh.
Get in trouble if we stray?
I think you're within bounds here, just in terms of what the operation of this would be. This would apply to the 11 who are not already covered by. So,
but
between the mediation agreement and this proposed stipulated order, all spots with the park would be covered.
Okay, so in effect, it covers everything.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Any other questions from staff or the council of staff? Is there anyone in the audience that would like to address this item? Not seeing any movement. Mr. Cook.
Doug Cook, 1447 2nd Street. The only question I had was fees, attorney fees and costs, item 11. Each party shall bear its own attorney fees and costs, blah, blah. I was just wondering, with our ongoing concern about expenses at the city's level, what was the cost of this location?
Do we have an estimate on that, city manager?
I have an estimate of $20,000.
Thank you very much. Seems like we got a good deal.
Thank you. Any other questions? All right, I will close the public comment and bring this back to the council for a further discussion, or we'll entertain a resolution on this matter.
I'll move we adopt the resolution.
Second.
We have a motion by Vice Mayor Dunsford to adopt the resolution as presented, and a second by Councilmember Krause. Are there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Good work, Matt. Richard.
Thank you, Matt, for your help. Thank you for hanging in there.
Thanks, Don. Bobby.
Don, the rest of this agenda is riveting. I mean, if you want to... Have a good evening. Bye, guys. Item number four. Consideration of a resolution authorizing the 2014-2015 Community Enrichment Grant Awards and possible budget adjustment in the amount of $5,000. The recommended action is to adopt the resolution. And I believe City Manager Spittler is going to take us through this. And Matt, I think you're free to go as well. Or Richard?
Have a safe trip back.
Okay. All right.
All right.
City Manager Spittler, item number four.
Yes, you have before you a recommendation of the Environment or the Community Enrichment Grant Subcommittee. Each year, the council, through the budget process, allocates approximately $5,000 to community groups that provide a service and benefit to the community that the city government does not provide. The deputy city clerks puts out requests for grant to the various nonprofits in town. We receive them, we package them up, and then the council subcommittee, consisting of Councilmember Lopez and Councilmember Krause, go over the applications, and they're charged with giving a recommendation to the city council. And so what I've presented to you right now is their recommendation. And there was approximately over $10,000 in applications that were submitted, and those are all in your staff report. And but there was a budget of $5,000. So there's been two options presented to the council this evening. One within the budget, and the second one would be $10,000, which would address most of the grant application requests. And that would require a budget amendment to add another $5,000 to the community enrichment fund. The recommendation of the subcommittee was Boys and Girls Club of St. Helena, $1,250. The Art Center, $750. Calistoga Cares, which is our food pantry, $750. Calistoga Christmas Bazaar, $500. Calistoga Tree Coalition, $500. And Up Valley Family Center, the after-school program of $1,250 for a total of $5,000. So that's option one. That's within the present budget. And so if the council adopts that resolution, there's no budget amendment needed. Then option two basically was pretty much funding all the requests at the full grant request amount. Boys and Girls Club, $4,000. Art Center, $750. Calistoga Cares, $750. The Bazaar, $1,000. Tree Collation, $1,000, in Up Valley Family Center, $2,500. So it's up to the council which they want to do. There are, in their staff report, are two resolutions, attachment 1A, which is within budget, and 1B adds $5,000 to this fund. Concludes my staff report.
Thank you very much. Council members, any questions?
I guess I'd on the committee with Iris. I'm sure Iris will have some comments as well. They were all good requests. Actually, the total request came just a little bit shy of $11,000. So they're in option two, there are some small reductions in some of the requests. What came to mind is the success that the city had with TOT tax, which came in even higher, I think about $100,000 than what we had predicted in our 14-15 budget. And additional $5,000 into this program, I think, helps the community in general. It does not hurt our next year's or this year's current budget in that our anticipated revenue increase certainly helps fund that. And like I say, I think they're all worthwhile projects, and perhaps Iris has something she'd like to add to it.
Yeah, I agree with Mr. Krause that all these programs are beneficial for the entire community, and you know, I agree that we should share some of our success on the little extra money that we have, because if I remember last year, we were not able to help all these programs. We're short on money, so I agree with him that these programs are very important and they will benefit for the children and for people.
And thank you both for serving on this committee. That legwork for us. I know it could be difficult to say no to some, and very rewarding to say yes. And out money at Christmas time type of thing. Other questions? I have a question regarding the application process for this. Groups applying, are they required to be a designated nonprofit organization? I see a majority of this list is. And I just wanted to make sure there was or was not a
right. We don't allow for-profits to apply. I suppose there could be a group that isn't formally 501c3, but if they're organized properly and could fund that, we don't fund for-profit.
Okay, but there's
we also only fund their expenditures. In other words, they need to submit receipts to us that says that they did with the money, but they said they were going to pay.
Okay, I just did want to make sure that there was not a requirement. Designated 501.
No.
Okay.
It's up to the council.
All right.
I have not a question. It's kind of an observation. I have rather mixed emotions about this one. Well, I agree with everything that's been said about the worthiness of these projects and the fact that we have more money. I'd hate to set the precedent of taking money that was not budgeted to do something when we had a fairly vigorous discussion on this very subject during the budget negotiations about how much to put in here. Should we put in more than we did the last year because we knew we were going to have more money this year? We decided not to, after quite some spirited discussion. And I hate to set the precedent of saying, well, it's only $5,000 more off of budget. And then the next time something comes along, and well, it's only $15,000. That's what the kind of thinking, not the numbers, but thinking that helped get us in the problems we were in 3 years ago. We had a surplus general fund of $18,000. So I'm very leery of taking money out of the general fund to augment budgeted items.
Being the fiscal conservative
that I try to be, it bothers me.
I recognize that, Jim, and the reason for my suggesting this is that the budget decisions that we made in the budget hearing was based upon a certain amount of revenue that we were anticipating coming in.
Correct.
After that was all set, we now find that there is another $100,000 that was underestimated.
Correct.
In that, and that may have changed the character of the discussion when we approved the budget. So that's why I bring it up.
And I agree with all of that. I agree with the thinking. I agree with the numbers. But as we will see in a later agenda item, all of a sudden we have an emergency no-bid situation for pumps. Now, there we're not talking $5,000. We're probably talking $50,000, $100,000. I don't know what that number is yet, and that's off budget. Now, that is something, or part of it could be off budget. That is something that I believe the general fund needs to respond to and respond to very quickly, whereas this is very nice, and I agree with all the wonderful things these organizations do. And having been the recipient at the Veterans Memorial of a grant some years ago, I know how wonderful it is to get it. So I have mixed emotions.
I understand. And
I just wanted to make that point to the public and the council.
About the emergency with the pumps, that's enterprise fund.
Yeah, but it's still money.
It is.
It comes down to budgeted item. I just wanted to make that clear to the council, my fellow council people here, and the public, that we are the guardian of these funds and we need to be responsible to them, for them, even if it's only $5,000. So That was my observation.
Other council members? This is a public, I will open this to the public. It's not a public hearing. If there's anyone in the audience wanting to address this matter, otherwise I'll bring it back. I share the opinion of Councilmember Barnes that as money starts flowing, people can start to throw it around, if you will. Now we are talking about relatively small sums, but it is the principle in matter. And one clarification, we ended up with extra funds not because we underestimated, but I think because one of our biggest taxing bases overperformed projections.
Correct.
Which is how we ended up with so much extra money. And even during our budget discussions, in fairness to Councilmember Krause and Councilmember Lopez-Ortega, when we did budget discussions in April, the projection between in April and May, the projections between April and the close of June on what TOT primarily was going to be, which was revised again, we even outperformed that. So I view that as a little bit of frosting on cake we didn't think we were going to have. So I'm comfortable with the extra 5,000, but philosophically,
thank you.
Appreciate the comment. So if there's any other discussion on that, we have two options before us. We have option one or we have option two. I, for one, am comfortable recommending option two, which is awarding to a community fund, awarding to amount of $10,000. With one
motion?
I will make a motion on option number two with one caveat that for, or at least a noted discussion that for future award recipients, that I think we need to be a little bit more strict about them being an actual designated nonprofit organization because there's financial tracking that goes with that that we don't have with all of these. And these are tax funds that are being handed to these organizations. So with that said, I motion that we adopt option number two as presented by the subcommittee of Councilmember Krause and Councilmember Lopez-Ortega.
Second.
I have a motion by myself and a second by Councilmember Krause. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you very much. Item number five, consideration of a resolution finding a local emergency pursuant to section 20168 and 22050 of the Public Contract Code and authorizing the expenditure of funds for emergency corrective action to the Dunawiel Wastewater Treatment Plant wet pit effluent pump without competitive bidding. The recommended action is to adopt the resolution, and I believe Director Kern will take us through this item.
Good evening, Mayor, Council Members. Mike Kern, Public Works Department. The item before you this evening is a resolution finding a local emergency for the purposes of purchasing and installing some new pumps at our wastewater treatment plant. And these pumps are basically the last part of the treatment process. Once the wastewater has gone through the treatment plant, it all ends up at this central location and then is either pumped to the riverside ponds for discharge to the Napa River or to the holding pond for recycled water distribution. One of the pumps had failed and we had done an emergency bypass with our portable pump. This fall or this summer, the second one failed. With that, we're basically without any pumps. In the extreme wet weather conditions, we will not be able to move the wastewater through the treatment plant process effectively, and we run the risk of having it back up and the plant become hydraulically overloaded. If that occurs, we would be discharging, we have the potential to discharge partially treated wastewater into the Napa River, and that would be not a good thing. So what we need to do is basically acquire two new pumps, hire a contractor to install them, and then hire an electrical outfit to set the motor controls and get everything wired up. Normally we would do this under competitive bid, but just to get the pumps ordered and delivered is about a 10 to 12 week process. Acting now will allow us to get those in just in time for the winter flows. If we don't, and we publicly bid this, we would be into November or January or February before we would have them installed, which is well beyond my comfort level of being able to keep the plant running smoothly. So the resolution before you makes certain findings, declaring a local emergency and authorizing staff to expend funds without competitive bidding. We have selected flight pumps as the pumps that we would like to install. They are predominantly the pump that we use in all of our wastewater treatment facilities, so we're maintaining some consistency there. We have identified a contractor that will do the work. We've gotten two quotes to make sure that the individual that we're selecting is competitive and he's well below the second quote, so I believe that we are getting good value for that level of effort. Because this is an urgency declaration, public contracting code requires that the item be placed on the agenda until it's resolved. So you'll see a standing item going forward until we have the pumps installed and completed. It will basically be a consent item that will just give you a status report going forward. With that, staff is recommending that you adopt the resolution making the findings incorporated therein and authorize the city manager to execute the purchase orders for the pumps and the contractor to install them. I'm here for any questions you may have.
Thank you, Director Kern. Council members, any questions of Director Kern?
Yeah. On five, it says, last winter, one of the two Pump X pumps failed and we had to place emergency trailer mounted pump temporary replacement. Could you give us a little insight into your thinking as to why, when the first one failed last winter, we didn't include a new one right away in our budgeting process and a way to avoid this emergency situation?
So when I should have said earlier that this is we do have budget for this. We did include this replacement in our budget. So there's $150,000 budgeted for that. So we anticipated that we would need to do something. I just didn't think we would need to do both of them. We pulled the pump and we sent it to E&M in Healdsburg to have it rebuilt. They tore it apart, and when the quote came back for the cost to rebuild it, I was not comfortable spending money on that rebuild, given that this was the third rebuild that pump had gone through. The quote to rebuild was a little over $7,000. It felt like I was putting good money to bad, given the fact that it had been rebuilt twice.
What's the lifespan of a pump like? I don't know anything about pumps.
Typically, we would expect a pump to last anywhere from 12 to 20 years. This one, both of these, barely gave us about 5 years before they had to be rebuilt. I'm not sure what the selection process was for them at the time that they were put in. My guess is that it was
cheap
and or equal.
Bitter.
And,
we were
and
broke.
Or equal. So part of what we're recommending is that we go with, you know, a very reputable brand of pump. We've had good results with this type of pump and good support services from their customer representative office out of Fairfield.
You said this new one is a Xylem Flight?
Xylem Flight. Flight has been around for probably 80 years. Xylem is kind of their new corporate owner, but it's the same type of pump.
Those are compatible with the other pumps that we have, and they seem to work better than this Pump X thing?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions, staff?
Not that it has anything to do with my vote, but is this a turbine pump or a centrifugal?
These are centrifugal.
It looked like it because I could see the volute on there, and
it's got a bowl.
Are we? Do we use flame hardened impellers on these to reduce the scoring on them?
Generally, what we would use down there would in this application would be a powder coated impeller and bowl. It allows for a smooth mating this is just wastewater. There's no solids or anything like that that go through there, so we don't
there
need to harden.
There isn't any sand or anything like that that might?
Generally speaking, no.
Okay.
The sand would be on the front end of the collection system and the treatment plant.
While there's a failure of pumps like this could result in sending something into the river that we don't want in the river, this has not happened.
That's correct.
Thank you.
And hence the reason we're here this evening.
Thank you. Any other questions of the council? Any questions from anyone in the audience? All right, I'll bring it back to council for consideration, or if anyone's interested in making a motion, we'll entertain that as well.
I'll make a motion that we pass the resolution declaring a finding of a local emergency and allowing Public Works Department to move forward with the purchase of the pumps immediately.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilmember Krause and a second by Councilmember Barnes. Any other discussion on this matter? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Director Kern. Item number... Bye, Matt. Thank you. Item number 6, consideration of a report on the status of Calistoga's emergency response and preparedness and direction to the city manager to prepare a draft unreinforced masonry ordinance. The recommended action is to accept the report, and this is going to be brought to us by City Manager Spittler.
Thank you, Mayor Kenning, members of the council. I wanted to report into the council about the event last Sunday, the earthquake in Napa, and how it affected Calistoga. As the mayor indicated earlier, we got a jolt, but we escaped damage and injury, and I'm very thankful for that. And I'm pleased the way our staff, police, fire, and public works respond in terms of an immediate survey of the community, both private buildings downtown and also our community essential facilities, from Kimmel Reservoir to Fish Tank to a wastewater plant. They all inspected a fire department several times during the night to make sure that nothing was compromised. As the mayor indicated, the fire department City of Napa asked for help from our fire department, Engine 19, and our three firefighters went down to assist in various fires and patrol of the city. Public works crews also went down later that week to help with street cleanup. But in checking in that Sunday morning, my office, the EOC, emergency operations procedures, I found that there's room for improvement, particularly on my end, as to how to respond should this disaster have struck Calistoga. Our emergency plan that we have adopted was adopted in 1997. We've had staff that kind of keep it up to date to some extent, and contacts, as well as specific procedures for dealing with a flood, for instance. We have good protocol for that, but we need a new plan. However, I'm pleased to say that the county of Napa and all the cities have been working the last year and a half to create a comprehensive multi-jurisdictional plan that would apply countywide as well as each individual city. And so we're looking for a draft to come out in February, early next year. So that matter is underway. I found that staff emergency personnel that need additional training. I'm talking particularly about the ICS disaster training for people like myself, finance department. There's various roles and functions that you play in a disaster beyond the first responders. And so we're behind on our training. And so that's well within my authority to direct staff to begin the training process. So what we're going to do is take key personnel and set up a training procedure, and there's various training classes that are put on free in the county and nearby counties, and so that's going to be a higher priority. Advantage of that is not only do they know what to do in an event, but it also qualifies us for state and federal disaster money should it elevate to that level. The last one was the status of our unreinforced masonry program, our URM program. The state adopted legislation in 1986 that mandated that cities inventory buildings of brick or masonry that don't have a sufficient reinforcement, rebar, whatnot. The city's inventoried them, but hasn't really moved any further in terms of requiring them to upgrade the buildings. You saw reports about Napa where they had a program that was about 90% complete, and so many of the older buildings are able to be saved or injury reduced because of that. It doesn't say that nothing will happen, but it basically allows enough time for someone to get outside of a building without being injured. I believe it's time for Calistoga to pursue some form of unreinforced masonry ordinance and a program to implement. This will take several years, but I would like a direction from the council to move ahead on that. We would meet with affected property owners. We had initially some 30 buildings identified, and it's kind of worked its way down to, I think, 10, and now maybe 4 left that need upgrades, but we're going to revisit all that. I would like to have staff meet with these property owners. I would like the Building Advisory Commission, who have 2 architects, 2 contractors, well-qualified people, to help come up ideas for a draft ordinance and a program to implement it and bring that up to the council at some future date. For your authorization to then go through the process to make it part of our municipal code. Financial impact of all this, the initial cost of having these 10 potential URM buildings, there's a technology to examine them to basically look to see if they have rebar and or metal support in the masonry. Cost in total probably $5,000 to $7,000, you know, maybe $1,000 each building, and one, it would be within our authority to mandate the property owners to pay for that. Another is out of our community development fund to expend $5,000 to $7,000 to work with each property owner to make sure that our list is accurate. What happens, I ran this program in Healdsburg a number of years ago. We got most all of them done and basically worked with the property owner. And many times you'll find something that's on the list and it's really is reinforced. And so you kind of get more information on each building. I will say, even with the unreinforced masonry program, this does not apply to wood structures, and if you've seen in the Napa quake, some of the old churches kind of leaning or wineries that were all wood, so they're not part of this program. They're potentially not as dangerous as the brick buildings, but it won't eliminate damage should a major quake hit this area. But we do have a responsibility under state law to move this program ahead, and so that the public and the owners of the building properly deal with, are protected, and the owners deal with this issue. I will say that if there's a major upgrade to a building, change of use, I remember a number of years ago, Bosco's, when they moved where Hydro is to where they are now, Mr. Seeger redid and put in all the URM protections in there so that building's secure. So as major renovations happen, we've been tackling them over time, but I think it's time to start the process to bring everyone into this program. That concludes my presentation.
Thank you. Council members, any questions?
Yeah, I think that, perhaps you know, perhaps Lynn knows. As we find buildings that need to be upgraded, of course, we're going to give them a certain time frame which to do it. Does the earthquake retrofit also trigger other code things like fire sprinklers, handicapped access, electrical upgrades, and like that. In other words, it might not just be as simple as someone paying for reinforcing their masonry construction. I'm thinking that there are probably other things that they're going to wind up getting into at the same time.
Well, you can structure the ordinance to, you know, be just the minimal to meet the URM requirements, the state requirements, or you can push it further to do other upgrades, and that's something this committee would examine. Obviously, if the fire chief is out there and inspecting and sees something that's hazardous, like loose wires, active wires, that you can order fixed. But you can set up these ordinances to go basically as far as you need them to go. And some communities have gone pretty far basically to address all those issues that you mentioned. Some of them, like the city of Oakland, deals with just the minimum to keep, you know, a shell, secure floors and ceilings and parapets so that they don't fall, they don't deal with anything else. So that's one of the issues that we're going to have to examine.
And then the other thing, as you mentioned, wooden structures. Ones that particularly tend to be on the end of a block, and one of which I can think of would be the All Seasons Cafe building that's there, because there isn't a building on another side of it to brace it when it starts swaying. Those wooden structures on the corners tend to fall, depending on the direction that the earthquake comes from, too. So there's All Seasons Cafe that I would be concerned about. And the other one that I'm concerned about is where you spend 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, sometimes more, that one could easily find itself out in the middle of First Street one of these days.
I promise my staff I'll hold to that. No, the City Hall, of course, it needs seismic bracing. It needs fire suppression, protect, all that stuff. And I'd like that. Building deserves a major renovation to protect it into the future. It's $800,000-$900,000 proposition, and I'd like to get to it someday. I think it would be a real good idea.
Other questions, Council?
Observation: as you were talking about money, the estimated cost $5,000 to $7,000, development fund. Another vehicle you might want to pursue is talk to our insurance broker, Viant. I know we're a bit of a contentious thing with them right now over the Monhoff, but some of the insurance companies will provide inspection services as part of your package. I don't know if the Lexington would be one of them. It's a big carrier, but if you can convince them through our broker that bringing these buildings back closer to code or up to code, forcing unreinforced masonry, that is in their best interest because they are providing earthquake coverage. I get that.
Thank you. Another question?
Any federal assistance?
I'm not aware of any. They're talking about a 20% tax credit for people that actually renovate their buildings, and that would be for the private developer. But this is a typical example where the state of California tells us to do something but gives us no money to deal with it. They say, well, you just pass it on to the property owner or the city pay for it. So I'm not aware of when there used to be redevelopment agencies like in Healdsburg, they provided some assistance to the owner to, because it was URM building was considered a blighted building and repair, and so it was a legitimate expenditure. But of course, the state took that funding source away as well. So I'm not aware of any.
Downtown would have been a great redevelopment thing that I'm sure we could have financed some of that, but all that's gone away too.
That's cool. They are talking about replacement legislation, but I see that as years away before it becomes reality.
All right, thank you. Any other questions? All right. No action taken, just accept the report.
Just on the idea of us paying for some of the testing of the buildings. I mean, it's the budgeted amount is within my authority, but whether you're interested in.
Do we have consensus that it is within city manager's authority, feel this worthy enough for him to proceed on? You have.
Obviously, if I found out it's expensive, I won't act on it.
All right, thank you very much. Item number 7, consideration of receiving a report regarding second annual Napa River and Calistoga Community Cleanup Event, September 20th, 2014. The recommended action is to accept the report. Taking us through this item, I believe, it's Director Kern.
Good evening, Mayor, Council Members, Mike Kern, Public Works Department. This is just a kind of a heads up that on September 20th at 9 o'clock, we'll convene here in the parking lot to conduct the second annual Calistoga cleanup. We've had some really good participation last year. We had about 43 people show up, and so we're hoping to equal that or better it. We've got some good prizes that have been donated by some of the local businesses, including the Chamber. Silverado Hardware has given us buckets and gloves, so we should be well protected. We have placed ads in the paper for this week and next week to let people know, and we've had some save the dates posted on Channel 28. So we're just looking forward to a successful cleanup. Last year we kind of spread out and went upriver a little bit, but I think the focus that we want to do this year is right here on the river down by the footbridge, and then along the Washington Vine Trail extension, and then also along the railroad right-of-way. There seems to be quite a bit of foot traffic there and quite a bit of material that we can pick up along there. So, and we'll probably go all the way down the pathway to Dunnewheel. So I'd like to break people up into different groups and let them go out and enjoy the day. Now, last year it rained, and so this year we're hoping for more rain.
That's what I was going to say.
I will say, though, if you look at Fairway, the trash that's out there, why are we picking up it up at River Cleanup Day? Well, if you don't pick it up there, it's going to wash down and enter the river. So it's all connected.
Thank you. And even with the rain last year, it was a pretty well-participated event.
It was fun.
Any other questions on this? I'd love to help you, but I'll be running from San Francisco to Dallas.
Thank you.
I'll wave on the way. Just one up. All right. Item number 8, consideration of canceling or rescheduling the November 4th, 2014 City Council meeting. The recommended action is to provide direction to cancel or reschedule November 4 for that City Council meeting. And the reason for this is obviously November 4th is Election Day, correct?
Right. The polls are open to 8 p.m. We start at 7, so there might be a conflict. What I would recommend is Council, by consensus, give authority to the mayor to, if I think we really need a council meeting that week, and it could be the next day, Wednesday, the 5th, that he has authority to direct me to have a special meeting. But I don't advise on election night to have a council
meeting. Why don't we schedule one for the 5th? And then if there's nothing has come up, say by Friday, whatever that date is, but then there have to cancel.
Okay.
Has certain posts that necessary. So when you would normally get your agenda out, instead of sending out an agenda, cancel the meeting.
So you can public notice the rescheduling from the 4th to the 5th, and then should there not be a significant enough agenda, we just cancel. Is that comfortable with everybody else? Breaking any protocols there, City Manager?
I've got to check. Usually every year you adopt the meeting schedule by resolution, and I didn't present it that way this evening. So I'll look into that, but I
blame that on you. But yeah. Wait till your evaluation. It'll be there.
If you need to bring it back next time,
yeah,
we'll
under consent,
it.
Yeah, okay, I can do that.
Okay, fair enough. All right, we'll adjourn this meeting tonight in memory of the two slain American journalists, and we'll adjourn to the next regularly scheduled meeting on September 16th at 7 p.m. in the Community Center. Thank you, and have a good evening.